A very good evening and welcome to the India Development Debate. I'm Tamanna Inamdar. The big question is, are we looking at the last week per se of lockdown? Are we prepared for life after lockdown? Are we truly seeing signs of the economy opening up, of business as usual in the new normal, of course? The first signs of hope were, of course, with some trains starting off today. The IRCTC has, tried to open up bookings, and some trains will start. There are hopes that more and more businesses will start manufacturing. Of course, the big question of labor still looms large. So where do we stand as far as life after lockdown is concerned? That's the big question today. And to speak with me on this, I'm joined by Sumant Sinha, CMD of Renew Power Ventures, Yami Iyer, President and Chief Executive of Center for Policy Research, R. Gopalan, former Finance Secretary, and Gautam Chikarmani, Vice President of ORF. Welcome to all of you and thank you for speaking with us. Mr. Sinha, let me get a corporate view from you first. We have seen corporate India trying to restart the wheels for some time now. Have things eased out, or are we suddenly looking at bigger challenges, especially in reference to labor?
Well, you know, I think it is given that we have to restart the economy. I think that is where the general consensus is moving to. But it's also coinciding with a point where there is a spurt in the number of cases that are being reported on a daily basis. And yesterday, for the first time, we crossed 4,000 cases. So we've got this strange dichotomy that is beginning to happen where there is now a general feeling that we need to restart the economy, but the cases are also increasing. So I think it leads to kind of mixed thoughts, I think, in most people's minds. And so also a fear of, and also a general sense of apprehension that, you know, while we do have to restart the economy, will that lead to yet another increase in the number of cases? So I think that is somewhere playing at the back of everybody's minds. But leaving that issue aside for a second, I think in terms of getting things restarted, you're absolutely right. Labor is a problem. And getting labor back from their respective home states is going to be an issue. In certain cases where labor has not yet gone back, the first thing that they actually want to do when trains do restart is actually to head back to their homes. And that's in some ways natural to understand as well, because, you know, people have a tendency of wanting to go back to their, to a comfortable place for them, ride out the storm and then perhaps come back when they feel that things are better.
Yeah.
And in a way, that's making it harder for everybody to get restarted. You know, in our case, for example, the good news for us was that all of our plants currently are working, and we have more than 100 plants all across different parts of India. Those have continued to work because power is defined as an essential service. But wherever we had construction going on of new projects, all of that came to a halt. And now we're finding it increasingly hard to get restarted because of the reason that labor is not there. But equally, parts and supplies are not there as well. And we don't know when, in fact, all of those things will become available. I think there's no shortcut to this. You just have to work through it. And hopefully over time, slowly, we'll be able to get our project construction site started again. The third aspect of that really is getting the head office started, or the various offices we have across different parts of India. And while we're now allowed to go into work from 7 a.m. in the morning to 7 p.m. or go anywhere for that matter, I think, you know, everybody is being very cautious about actually getting people to come back to the office, because the last thing you want to go back and for a case or two to arise, first of all, you put the safety of people at risk. And then secondly, of course, you may have to shut the office down again. So I think people are just going to wait and watch how things evolve. Maybe wait until the lockdown ends on the 17th, see what kind of messages are coming from the government, see, you know, what they say. The also with the district that you're operating in, maybe red zone, you know, red or orange or green. So that classification may also change. And that may also have an impact on people's thinking. So I think a lot of corporates will probably play it safe for the time being, as far as offices are concerned, and perhaps begin to restart only a few days later, once we get a better directional sense of where we're heading to. So I think that's how different people are going to approach this.
You know, that's the key question. Is there a clear direction right now? Yamini Iyer, let me come to you on this point. And, you know, let me focus a bit on the point of labor, where there are mixed messages, I would put it. On the one hand, you have this big humanitarian crisis with, you know, migrant workers trying to make it home. Then you have states and industry wanting to keep them back because you want to restart work as well. You have some states, quote unquote, easing out labor laws to encourage work coming together. Do you see labor emerging as a huge issue in the weeks and months to follow?
Oh, absolutely. I think that's going to be the most critical and most tension-filled issue going forward. I think that the policy response across central and state governments over these last 7 weeks has not instilled any real confidence in the minds of labor, given the way in which we were slow, the policy response was slow to begin with. It has been confused. We still haven't been effective in terms of even providing big relief measures to those who are stranded and also to those who have gone home. We've sent very, very mixed signals about what it means for labor to go home and what it means for labor to come back to work. And in all of that, I think we've created a context where basic trust has been broken. The very fact that people were willing to undertake a long and arduous journey on foot should be an indication that labor recognized that they were in an uncertain moment in a very inhospitable place with absolutely no trust in the state to actually ensure that they are well protected. They went home, they have protested. And I think the response that governments are providing by not actually on a war footing initiating a sensible social insurance and social protection system, and instead indicating that they are erring on the side of capital and not trying to work the balance between capital and labor, is going to make it very hard to convince people to come back. It is quite clear people are waiting for things to open up so that those who are left behind can go home. And it is the job of government to build trust, not to indicate that they are doing very little to bring labor back and ensure that they are well protected.
You know, the question is that, okay, a lot of people have gone home, a lot more will want to go home, and then what happens? You know, how will we see a new kind of status quo? Gopalan, would you, you know, like to sort of talk about how the entire labor conundrum, as you know, we've been calling it, is also symptomatic of this, I would say, communication mismatch between center and state?
Well, there was a clear lack of coordination in handling this labor issues. There is a demand for labor in areas where activities would pick up, but the way the labor have been treated, even by the society, by just in indicating to them that they are not wanted and they are a nuisance to us during this time of COVID crisis. That was even by households and by various other people, that became a bit of a problem. And secondly, you would also find that many agencies, economic agents, did not have the wherewithal to support this labor during the time of lockdown. They themselves were living really on a marginal way they were living. So they didn't have enough resources to help the labor to induce the labor to stay. So unless you have some kind of an employment insurance or some way in which a social security is provided to the migrant labor and their needs, like rations through ration cards, transferable ration cards across the country, unless you do all these kind of measures which will give them the confidence to stay back wherever they are, even if the COVID like of a crisis is going to strike later, unless that is done, I personally believe that we will be witnessing these kind of chaotic scenes as we go along. Unless we put our act together, this will repeat.
And what is going to be the repercussion of this, Gautam, if you want to come in on here? Because, you know, you're seeing a situation where now industry is trying to start again, and small, medium, micro, big, everyone is now got that big question on their mind. Who will come back to work? How do we get them back to work?
So on the labor part, I agree with all my co-panelists here. And I find that the ball of decision making lies with state governments and companies. Now, in order to attract companies, and for instance, in the last 3 days, three governments have come out and said that we are going to make some changes. All three governments have made different rules. For instance, if you look at Madhya Pradesh, I think they have a very good plan ahead. They have Shivraj Chauhan has come out with a policy which says, which has simplified the procedures for making doing business easier. For instance, and this also comes under labor reforms. So all registrations in a day, all license to be granted for 10 years rather than one, shops to be open from 6 to midnight, the number of registers has been decreased from 63 to 1, the number of returns from 13 to 1, and so on. The threshold of inspectors has been raised to 50 from 20. So these are the procedural reforms around labor that the Madhya Pradesh government has done. If you now move to Uttar Pradesh, and I think what Shivraj Chauhan has done will attract capital within India as well as from abroad. He has made a clear case that he wants to get the companies which are exiting China into Madhya Pradesh. Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat, which are the other two states that have come out with some policies, are confused. Uttar Pradesh said that we are going to stop all labor laws, except suspend all labor laws for 3 years, except the one on the Bandhua Mazdoor. I'm forgetting the exact name of the acts, but there are three acts which said, apart from that, we are going to suspend all other acts. When you do that, you are immediately in conflict with the Constitution. For instance, in 1982 and 1983, the Supreme Court has ruled that not paying a minimum wage is violative of Article 23. So this is what happened on May 6. By the time 2 days have passed, there is no ordinance yet. In the work in progress ordinance that the Uttar Pradesh government has brought out, which is undated so far, it is saying that minimum wages will be applicable and the final ordinance is yet to come. I think Uttar Pradesh is still dealing with the problem. Gujarat has said that we are going to ease all labor laws for 1,200 days, approximately 3 years, and but the minimum wages and safety will be undercover. I think a lot of action, policy action, is now happening in the states. The kind of reforms 2.0 that many of these panelists have, I have sat with them and we have discussed this earlier, that we want the next generation reforms to come, I think are going to come in the states. I think they are beginning to happen now. I think Shivraj Chauhan has set the ball rolling and others may follow. But each state, I believe, will come out with its own rules, own laws and regulations and changes going forward. The problem with Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat is that they're doing it only for 3 years. I don't know which company will want to work on incentives that are only there for 3 years. Shivraj Chauhan has done it for 10 years. So I think there is going to be a lot of layering between how states are reacting or coming out with policy changes. I would say Madhya Pradesh is reforming. Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat are on the edge. I'm not sure.
The fact is, many states are figuring it out. Many states are figuring it out because the priority remains containing the number of cases. And then if you are a state with a large migrant population coming in, you have a whole other set of concerns. Yamini, you wanted to come in on this point.
Yeah, I wanted to say a few things. I think first and foremost, we shouldn't confuse the crisis with the process of reform. I think that everybody wants to try and load lots of things onto the crisis. This is a particularly unique crisis that has in fact laid bare many very critical fault lines in our economy and in our society. The first thing that we have to do is to build confidence, to regenerate and reinvigorate any attempt at addressing what are very, very contentious issues. There is a reason why this country hasn't gone in for big ticket labor reforms for many, many decades, despite industry asking for it, because these are very, very complex. This is not a time when every part of our political system is suspended. Legislative assemblies are not working. Parliament is not in session. To push changes through ordinances without debate, these are far-reaching critical changes. We have seen how ineffectively our state has been able to protect rights of workers. It's there laid bare on headlines across international television for us to see. Let's first ensure that we are able to at least address the kinds of challenges that have been presented to us in a way that is sensible. We can't push things hastily without ensuring the right processes and procedures are in place. The real challenge to investment, in my opinion, is our failed governance. Those should be fixed first. We can layer on reforms as we go along over time.
You know, the whole basis of saying that X, Y, and Z reform or law or lack of thereof will push investment, I think is also something that needs to be examined. R. Gopalan, I'm coming from this
point. May I just come in here? Just want to counter Yamini. I'm saying, why are we looking at it in an either or here? I think both are necessary. The labor needs to be given the securities. It needs to be given the confidence. There is no doubt and nobody is arguing against it. But reforms too are necessary. And if a crisis like the one which we are going through is the beginning of certain reforms, there is no problem. I think governments are dealing with both. My focus was only on the reforms part right now because the labor part has been taken care of. Of course, labor needs to be protected. And hence, that is the differentiator between Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh. But that reforms are necessary, it's not an either or.
My point is actually a little different, which I was coming to R. Gopalan with, and then I'll come to Sumanth as well. I'm saying that are these reforms really going to boost investment? That's the plan here, right? You reform, you want to attract people coming in. Uttar Pradesh is possibly thinking now we have a large number of people who've come back into the state. Instead of them going out again to find work, let's provide employment here. That's a stated goal. My question is, how is that going to happen? Remember, investments were drying up and sputtering even before COVID-19 hit. R. Gopalan, right now, is that the way to go forward as we're trying to open up? What is really the top priority and what should be the top priority right now? Because no one seems to be in a mood to start, investing heavily.
Yamini, you know that, reforms have been done in this country mostly at times when they are so critical and so really bad. So that's the time reforms have happened in this country politically. Probably this is a time to do this kind of a reform, but not in the haphazard and confused manner as ministers have done, as Gautam has very clearly indicated. The reforms have to be properly planned and then done. It should be done. This is the time to do the reforms, and therefore this is a very, very important thing. The point to answer Tamanna is that this is not the only thing. This is an important ingredient for inviting investment, but this is not the only thing. Today we don't have emasculation of demand as well as supply. Now, unless those issues are addressed immediately, for instance, I'll give one or two issues on the demand and supply side. The supply chain's bottleneck has to be removed drastically. You have such confused things like red zones where the consumption and growth is taking place. You don't allow movement across goods and services. Now then, how can the other areas which are green and orange will be in a position to start kicking up an economic activity? Now look at the other side of it. On the demand side of it, you have a lot of MSMEs and those industries who do not have the money to really start operation. Now, what do we do? You have not come up with a package as of now. We are expecting one that will come. But unless that package is meaningful to these economic agents to start the activities, I don't expect any demand to be generated. I'll stop it only one item of demand and supply. That needs to be looked into immediately. Once that is done, then only things will start moving. Then all these reforms of getting the labor reforms, getting other reforms regarding financial markets, capital, and unfortunately savings are going to go up because people are so confused, so uncertain. The savings will go up and the savings rate in the country will go up, keeping money for investments to take place in the country. But a lot of other things will have to happen because of the COVID-19. A lot of changes will happen in digitization, in the way the healthcare infrastructure and investment is going to take place. A lot of changes will happen in this country on account of this COVID-19. But let us settle first things first.
And what are those first things first, Mr. Gopalan?
Well, as I mentioned to you, let us get a package for MSMEs implemented.
Immediately. The package.
That is number one. And number two, let us see that credit flows which are not happening to NBFCs and others, MFs and those kind of matters, let them be addressed immediately, number two. Okay. Number three, let government come up with a credible plan of how they are going to kickstart the economy, not only MSMEs and all other aspects. How are they going to do that? Let them come up with a credible plan, including fiscal deficit and how management of that. Let them come up with a plan on this. Let us ensure that the financial markets are further liberalized, so that we'll be in a position to attract capital for industries to take place. then let us ensure that the FDA rules and laws are, made simple and operationalized, and ease of doing business is done as effectively as we can, so that things can start moving. There is a whole chain of things which need to
happen. Okay, let me get, I know Yamini wants to come in, but let me just, Sumanth has been waiting. So let me just get a quick word from Sumanth, and then I will come back to you, Yamini. Mr. Sinha, on the question of investments, labor laws are being tweaked. You need to have, changes in the labor laws. They are archaic. Is this the right time? Is a question that Yamini has raised. Can you do it at the cost of the welfare of workers? Possibly it will not be a workable solution over the long time. It will, distort the whole market. My question is that, is the investment appetite even there with so much uncertainty facing people? I mean, today, people are possibly not able to decide whether they want to buy even a new phone, forget about a new car or a new flat. So when demand is on such shaky ground, how do you plan forward? How do you kickstart the economy?
I think we have to sequence everything. And I think the need of the hour right now is for the government to announce some sort of a stimulus package or a support package, or call it what you will. But there has to be some support given to various sections of the economy, whether it is MSMEs, whether it is large corporates, medium-sized corporates, consumers, what have you. I think there needs to be something, because the reality is that at this point in time, we're heading for not just negative growth, but significant negative growth. And we all know that COVID-19 is going to be here with us for quite a while. It's not going away anywhere. And therefore, economic activity is not suddenly going to bounce back. It is going to stay depressed for a long period of time. And in this time period, even though the government's coffers themselves are limited, I think this is not the time to focus on fiscal deficit any longer. We have to start basically doing something which is able to at least get the economy back to maybe even zero growth is perhaps something to aspire for this year. So I think that's really where the government's focus at this point in time needs to be. Now, you have to separate the central government from the state governments. The labor law changes have been announced by the state governments. I don't think that there is any real thought through, well-articulated reform program that is being implemented, of which the labor reforms are the first step which are being done by the states. I don't think that is the case at all. I don't think the central government is thinking about long-term structural reforms in the Indian economy at this point in time, because they're not even able to do whatever is urgent and imperative and critical to be done right now. Right? So I don't think their mind is thinking, let me not do these urgent and critical things today, but let me start thinking about what I need to get the economy going 5 years from now. I don't think that they're thinking that. I think it's just some state governments, suo motu, have decided to differentiate themselves in some way or the other, right? By making a virtue out of this whole China substitution replacement type thing. And therefore they've announced whatever they've announced, and then they became a little bit competitive. And so they're doing. So I don't think we should read anything more than that into these announcements by these state governments, because on a piecemeal basis by itself, this can't be any kind of a reform measure, right? So I think all of us are in agreement on that. So I think as far as corporates are concerned, right now the time is for survival. Right now the time is to be conservative. And that is not just in India, but it is globally the case, right? Other than people investing large sums of money into Reliance Jio, I don't think anybody else is thinking about making any large investments in anything new at this point in time. So I think that's really what I believe. And so I think let's focus on the government doing something for the here and now. Let's survive. Let's live through this time period, both as individuals and as corporations. And then let's worry about the future after we survive to get to the future.
The question is, though, can you survive and also thrive? Which is why these considerations become very important. Those who adapt and, think.
Thrive is a relative term, and I may be thriving if everybody else around me is dying, even though I may not be really doing that well myself. So maybe just survival in this time period is maybe akin to thriving in some other time period. So I think we all have to reset our expectations and reset our bars and not try to do things which are heroic in nature.
I think Sumanth, that is candid best today.
Actually, this is reality. Samanda, this is not candid best. This is the reality of where we are right now as a country and as a global economy. let's not delude ourselves into thinking that there is some sort of a great sort of a Candyland type situation right now. We're in a very difficult spot. And it's going to take us a lot of effort and a lot of digging to get through this. And it's going to take us a couple of years or thereabouts to get through it. Now, therefore, what the government needs to do is sequence everything. Yes, get through the current problems that we are facing right now. And then subsequent to that, start thinking about long-term structural reform measures, which are also very critical eventually to attract more capital investment.
Mr. Sinha has laid out a sequence, Mr. Gopalan laid out a sequence. Yamini, you wanted to come in. Are you in agreement that step one has to be this package, this financial package, which now, people are saying any week now, we have stopped speculating about it because really when it comes, it comes. And then we'll see what's actually in it. There's no point waiting for, blue moon sort of sighting. But do you think that's step one, the package?
Absolutely, 100%, 1,000%. It's been 7 weeks. We are still waiting for this package. And I'm frankly baffled as to why it's taking so long, especially when you're about to put the on switch back on. If you want business to start up, if you want firms to start up, both firms and workers are going to face very uncertain circumstances. They need confidence, and that package will help build that confidence. So there's no question that is absolutely necessary. And the focus has to be to at least maintain the here and now. And that links to the second point I wanted to make in response to some of what my fellow panelists have been saying, back to that labor issue. Again, I think, what is your starting point? When you have witnessed the fact that workers are so unprotected that once they lose their jobs, they have almost no safety, and they'll walk home. I think the starting point has to be, how do we build a social insurance that can at least protect the here and now? And we'll get to the second stage. I'm not arguing that labor reforms are not necessary, but they have to be part of a larger package of structural reforms that also look at governance and pulling those together in a sensible way that addresses a lot of the tensions that we have seen going forward. Third thing, I think a point that was made by Sumant earlier, there's no doubt we are going to see a significant rise in cases as the economy slowly starts getting back. And that is going to require a very different kind of communication and approach from government than we've seen so far. We know that the social response to this has been one that in many ways has worryingly stigmatized people, which is then preventing people from coming from accessing medical services. And also, as more migrants go home, this is going to get exaggerated. We know that state governments are ramping up testing, but I think to do this right, a government needs to instill confidence in what its health preparedness is so that that addresses some of the stigma. But also we need to relook at how we are imagining testing, because testing should partly be for therapeutic and medical purposes, but it also should be to help us understand the nature of disease spread better. So states are now beginning to think a little harder about the role of testing. And that's where I think ICMR and the medical establishment needs to come into play to get us to figure out how to test in a way that will enable early detection so that we prevent an outbreak rather than testing only at certain points when we hit the hotspot.
More frequent testing,
testing, not just more frequent, that we're beginning to do. It has to be thoughtful and well planned so that it addresses both the economic issues for which testing are necessary as well as the medical issues.
Okay, so let me put this. Maybe succinctly, and also get Gautam in on this. Essentially, as we move forward, we are going to have to, increase our tolerance, quote unquote, to COVID-19 cases. They are going to grow. They are going to grow. And now beyond the point, does the question now need to be asked that can we remain locked in further to reduce it? We're going to have to think beyond this lockdown social distancing formula.
Yeah, so the problem is that you can die of the disease or you can die of, not hunger, but allied issues. But I don't think anybody is dying of starvation as yet. And I think all governments are making attempts to ensure that food is given, basics are provided for. And there could be some anecdotes here and there. But overall, I think it's going in the right direction. The economy has to come back. If it comes back, people will come out. They will get infected, as Yamini just said. And I think, I don't know how much of a risk as a government or as a nation we want to take with this. it's easy to say that those who have the wherewithal to stay at home or not work, to say that the economy must start, but the people who are vulnerable there, perhaps new norms have to be drafted in terms of physical distancing. Social distancing, I think, is a wrong word. There should be managing how to manage physical distancing while continuing. So the Delhi government, for instance, has said that 1/3 of the people can come to work. Now, how do they come? What are the details? What are the new SOPs? I think these are the policy designs that need to now come out. And we must not over-regulate either. I think some bit of leeway should be left to the people themselves, that they should want to be protected and they should be able to manage their economic well-being along with their physical well-being in some sort of a balance. But the fact is that labor is gone. It has to be called back. There have to be social protections, no doubt about it. How do we call them back? Is this going to be a new normal here? Is the labor, are wages going to go higher in order to replace the workers there or to attract them back? These are the issues that I think the CFOs of various companies would be grappling with. If wages rise, if social protections rise, it's a good thing. It's a good thing for everybody. It's a win-win for all. But will businesses be able to sustain those higher wages, those higher costs? We don't know. Will they move to robotics? We don't know. So I think at this moment, the reset button is easy to say that we want a reset, but that reset is a very dangerous button. So it could go either way. No doubt about it. There is a short-term requirement as well as a long-term. I don't see any conflict between the two. I think both have to go together.
Now, you know, I just want to get one last point from Mr. Gopalan about the role of states and central government working on this together. Now, a lot of people I speak to talk about a dissonance there. There is one rule from the central government, then there is an interpretation by the state government, their own version. Then down the ranks of authority, there are, again, it becomes like Chinese whispers. So the guy trying to restart, his factory, it now is dealing with the interpretation of the officer in front of him. And that is causing a lot of heartache. Do you think that there is a way to iron this out?
Well, what should have been done, in my view, is that Government of India giving a broad clarification of things and let the state governments work out the details themselves. That should have been done because each state has its own, factors and exigencies. The growth of the coronavirus patients. There is every state has its own paradigm which is there. So the state should have been allowed to work out the details. And once the state works out the details and disseminates to the districts and other authorities, there should be a way in which they should have said, these things are automatic, no need to get approvals. We should trust the industry, let them do the job. If you find that some violation takes place, obviously you take a very drastic action against the industry. Otherwise, these activities must be left to the industries themselves to manage. I think we need to start trusting at lower levels. We need to start trusting the industry. We need to start trusting the other economic agents who really contribute to the welfare of the economy. We should start doing that. But at the same time, we should also see that if there is violation, the punishment takes place very swiftly and very harsh punishments are done so that there won't be any incentive for anyone to repeat such mistake. It should have been the way it should have been rolled out. But yeah. Obviously, there are some communication gaps in between, probably that has worked to the detriment of the people who are at the receiving end.
Yeah, you know, last word from you, Yamini. We are now ending, hopefully this is the last week of 3.0, lockdown 3.0. Clearly, everything is not going to change from the 17th of May. Containment zones will still be sealed off. Hotspots will still be sealed off as they should. But can we hope for some clarity on things like online delivery, on things like, can clinics stay open? You know, on things like that, which can just make life a little less harder.
Absolutely, we absolutely need that clarity. Most importantly, I think firms and workers need clarity on what is it that the government is going to have for them as support. I think I'm hopeful that this should come a little earlier in the day than the last day, than on the 16th of May. The biggest problem has been that every time the lockdown is about to end, literally 4 hours or 5 hours before, a very long and complicated notification will be issued, which then leaves everyone scratching their heads. So what I'm hoping for in the next 5 days is an economic package that is clear, a government notification from the Home Ministry that is only one page with only three bullet points that can give us clarity on what we need to do next, some interpretation of that by somebody who's not a bureaucrat so that I can understand it and make up my mind whether we need to open up our office or not. And last but most important, clear guidelines from the center so that states can work out, and states will also hopefully do the same with their districts and local governments, how next to move forward with coordination committees at the center.
Wow, that's quite a wish list. And it's a good one. It's a good one. Thank you so much, Yamini Iyer, Gautam Chikarmane, Mr. Gopalan, of course, and Suman Sinha for joining us on the big debate this evening. We'll take a very short break, but we'll be back soon with a lot more. Don't go.